Hey, hello. Welcome to Provoking Safety. My name's Kevin. I'm a health and safety professional, and this is my channel. It's always been my desire as a safety professional to make health and safety as simple and as easy to do as possible. So kind of the goal of this channel. My desire is to get people thinking, talking, and doing safety. So that's the tagline. It's the channel where we think, talk, and do safety with the intention of provoking it at home and in the workplace. Now, today, this is another episode of 7 Minutes of Safety. I want to talk to you about the hierarchy of controls, the different levels that we use as far as controls go to reduce hazards and reduce the risk of hazards manifesting in the work that we do. So how do you control hazards? What's the best way? Is there a prioritized approach? Is there an order? These are all good questions. So let's put 7 minutes down here on the clock. Okay, and we're going to get into it. So what do we use the hierarchy for? How is it applied? Basically, it's for hazard assessments, where we're looking at the tasks that are performed with certain positions or jobs, if you will, and then applying these controls to reduce the risk of the hazards manifesting and, yes, experiencing consequences. Each task within the job is analyzed, and then the controls are applied to reduce the risk and or hopefully eliminate the risk. There are 5 levels in the hierarchy. The first one, the most important, of course, is elimination, then substitution, engineering, administrative, and finally personal protective equipment. I'll just take a few minutes and we'll look at each. Well, hopefully get this all done in 7 minutes. That's the goal. In high-risk situations where the risk is great of the hazard manifesting and, of course, the hazard having some significant consequences, ideally, what you want to do is eliminate. Okay, get rid of either a significant amount of the components of the task or get rid of the task altogether. Unfortunately, it also comes down to money, risk versus profit, but at least risk is being considered. Take, for instance, a lot of landscaping companies are no longer doing any kind of tree removal or landscaping where they're going to be in close proximity of power lines for just the simple reason that there's a high risk of contacting the power lines with extreme consequences, severe injury, fatality, etc. Also consider this, another way that you can look at elimination is inclement weather. If it's a bad snowstorm and you got to drive somewhere, do you have to drive? Can you eliminate the need and can you maybe substitute the task? Which is going to take me to the next point. Substitution. Can some of the elements of the task or the set of tasks, can they be changed and altered in any way? Now, the most commonly used example is floor sweeping. And that means changing a dry sweeping method or the dry sweeping compound for a wet one, or wetting down the area and sweeping it up. It reduces airborne particulate and therefore reduces the respiratory threat or the respiratory risk. Another example is exchanging a caustic cleaner for a less hazardous one, or using a more stronger detergent method versus a caustic cleaner. Another method you might, or another thing that you might think about, is the use of electric equipment in enclosed areas instead of gas-powered equipment. Reduces fumes, reduces carbon monoxide. Dealt with a situation some years ago where I had to investigate some carbon monoxide poisoning, and it was found that the basement was being power troweled with gas-powered machines and it was completely enclosed. That's a case where a hazard assessment should have been done, and then looking at using electric-powered machinery versus the gas-powered machinery. The next point, of course, is engineering controls. These are built and designed in such a way that there's very little worker interaction. The idea is that they're either automatically work or with some minor setup, they're going to be doing their job without having worker interaction or the worker doing anything to them. So these involve some different methodologies or different methods. One method, of course, is to form a barrier between the hazard and the worker. A process control where something is activated before the process takes place, like an interlock on a machine where you may have to close something and it's locked before the machine actually starts working. And another method is just removing the hazard from a worker. So for an example, a barrier might be shielding in a manufacturing or process environment where a worker's using controls and there's shatterproof glass and shielding between them and what's being manufactured. That's an engineering control. Another simple engineering control to think of is a guardrail on the edge of a roof when roofers are working to keep them from falling over the edge. Another example. Now, process controls are just an interlock process. And you know what? Here's a very simple interlock. When you're driving your vehicle, most modern vehicles, when you start them, they start great, but they will not move into gear until you put your foot in the brake, or the clutch and the brake are activated in the case of a standard transmission. There's lots of cases where interlocks are involved, even in a household setting. Washing machines won't actuate unless the lid is closed, dryers won't work unless the door is closed, etc. Simple idea of an interlock or a process control to remove the hazard from the worker. Now, another way of removing the hazard from the worker is just a method of extraction, for instance. Ventilation, such as when a welder's welding or somebody's working with carpentry tools or cabinet making tools and pulling the contamination away from the worker. Engineering controls. Another method is what's called an administrative control. We're working our way down the list of the hierarchy controls. It's the fourth one, almost the last one. Now, administrative controls adjust how a worker works or a worker approaches their work or adjust some way the tasks are being performed. Administrative controls fall under a lot of different categories. Training is one of them, instruction, written instruction, shift alteration. Other administrative controls, of course, are signage, barricades. Whether you're erecting construction fencing around your project to reduce unnecessary traffic, which it protects both the workers doing the work and the public, or assembling components on the ground before lifting them up to a height and reducing the risk of falls, although it does involve the use of a crane as well. But depending on the area, you might want to assemble everything and then lift it. As I said, warning signage such as hearing protection must be worn beyond this point, eye protection, hearing protection, etc. Often these signs are used in conjunction with personal protective equipment, which brings me to the next point. Personal protective equipment are the lowest level of the hierarchy of controls for a few reasons. Number one, they require 100% worker involvement. Number two is usually the maintenance of them is a lot quicker of a turnaround. And finally, number three is the barrier between the worker and the force is a lot of times not adequate enough, and it's extremely close to the worker. In other words, a hard hat's right on your head, your gloves are right on your hand. So it's the last line of defense, really, when it gets right down to it. Now, common examples, of course, are like back here, hard hat, gloves, eye protection, hard-toed boots. Some others you might want to think about are like high-vis vests like this one, or specially designed clothing like I used to wear when I worked in the logging industry. I used to wear Kevlar-lined pants for using a power saw because they would stop the chain and bind it. Lots of different examples of PPE. When you go to the hospital or a clinic or whatever, and the person seeing you may wear gloves. Those gloves aren't necessary for surgery. Those are exam gloves, and they're to protect them from the transmission between you and them. They're personal protective equipment as well. Another thing you have to consider is the controls are often combined and layered. For instance, it's not unusual to see workers working at a high level, and they'll be wearing a fall protection harness with a lanyard that's attached to an anchor point, but there may be interspersed guardrails. Or they may be wearing what's called a fall restraint, where it reduces the amount of travel to, say, the edge of the area, but that edge will have a guardrail as well. It's not unusual to layer controls for maximum protection. A good example of a layered control is in your vehicle. Right from the get-go, when vehicles were invented, first thing they had was lap belts. I'm old enough that I can remember that's all some vehicles had. And then they went into a cross body belt that was combined with the lap belt. And then there's an inertia brake so that when you went forward, it stopped you after it reached a certain amount of inertia. Then there's interlocks built in where the vehicle buzzes and chimes until you plug in your seatbelt. And of course, the advent of airbags, side curtain airbags, and it seems that driving is getting safer and safer, but that's the notion of layered controls. I'm going to talk more in a future video regarding layered controls and other protections, so stay tuned for that. We use hazard controls in everyday life, whether we're putting on a seatbelt, as I mentioned, or if you're the passenger, or we don gloves when we're raking leaves to avoid blisters, or even when we want to go to the market and we're wearing a mask now. I know, these days. But the important thing is assessing hazards, considering ways to eliminate them or at least control the risk. That's the main thing. Anyway, thank you very much for joining me with this video. As I mentioned at the beginning, if you enjoyed the content, do me a favor, let me know. Click that like button. If you didn't, by all means, you go ahead and click that unlike button. But let me know why. Leave me a comment down below. If you're new to the channel and you haven't done so yet, click that subscribe button. Ding the bell, you'll get notified of new content. Do me a favor until I see you next time. Think safety, talk safety, do safety with the intention of provoking it at home and in the workplace. Take care. Bye for now.